Hello, I'm Cara Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's the bench.
And here's me. There's not always a bench. That's a metaphor.
Here we go.
That's stupid. This is kind of fun.
I take all types, but it's just basic coffee. Yeah. I don't like fancy things. I like Americanos with some sugar-free hazelnut. It's got to be the low-calorie stuff.
Yes, of course.
What do you drink?
Any, really. Yes. Mm-hmm.
I don't think Starbucks is as good as it used to be.
I'm not the greatest fan, but I still go there. Just especially
too.
In this town, there's not that many just small coffee shops. I'm sure you have a lot of great ones in San Diego.
Well, actually, the good one is at Nordstrom's. They have a great coffee, and in Barnes & Noble, they do Starbucks. But they actually do good coffee. They seem to take pride in it. I don't know, sometimes it comes out pretty weak.
Yeah.
I'm sitting in the lobby of Valley Baptist Church, Bakersfield, where I played a concert last night, and fascinating organ, actually ex-Harvard University, and for a time was owned by Virgil Fox, and it was a total joy to play, great turnout. And happens to be here, sitting next to me, and was in the audience last night, is a great young emerging artist, Karissa Lystrup. Karissa, thank you for joining us
on the bench. Glad to be here.
It is lovely to have you. Now, do you remember the first time you heard an organ?
Yes, absolutely. The first time is probably before I was even born, because my parents grew up taking us to Christmas Eve services at a big church right in the middle of town, and so always heard the organ played there, but it wasn't until I was around 17 that I heard a Christoph Bohl concert, and that was the first time I said, I want to do that. I remember him asking for themes from the audience and then weaving it all into one improvisation at the end of the concert, and it was just incredible, and I thought, oh, that's what I want to do.
That's great. Had you been studying piano before then?
Yes, I started piano when I was 3 years old, actually.
Three?
Yes, taking from my great aunt, who had been, I can't tell how old she is, but she's quite old, and she's still teaching, so that's why I can't tell how old she is.
So 3 years old?
Yes.
So you probably couldn't read the time? I was the same.
Really?
I couldn't read the name of the piece, but I could, you know, bash away and play the thing. And I mean, that's amazing.
I think it's really an ideal age to start. I've taught many students from that young, and if you have the focus, it's really an ideal age. You're learning languages, and it's why not add another language of music at that point?
That's it. It's a language, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Music is a language.
Absolutely.
So starting the organ at 17,
yes.
Did you probably, you know, you knew what you wanted to do. Did you decide then that you wanted to be an organist in the church or whatever?
So the way it happened is the organist at our church was having a baby, and she had the hardest time finding good substitutes. So she knew I played piano. She had taught me a little bit. She was wonderful. She had her doctorate from USC and everything. So she said, you know, I'll give you 6 months of lessons. That's when the baby's coming. Do you think you could be ready to cover my maternity leave? And I said, I will try. And I thought it was going to be easier than it was, to be honest. I ended up spending 4 or 5 hours a day at the church, you know, trying to learn how to play hymns and all that.
It's hard, isn't it?
It is. No one thinks it is, but it truly is a skill. So, yeah, that was after that 6 months and getting to play those first six services in my home parish is when I started looking for organ work and looking towards school for organ as well.
So where did you decide to go and do your studies?
I had already been playing in a church for a couple of years, and then I decided, I think I was about 20 when I actually started officially enrolled full-time in university for organ study.
Where was that?
Concordia University in Irvine, yes.
So who were your tutors there?
Esther Jones was who I studied with my first about 2.5 years, and then Tom Mueller was my final year.
So how was it at Concordia? I mean, after doing lots of private study and then you go to university, what was the difference?
I'd say it was just wonderful to be in an environment where there's so much collaboration that happens. That's something very unique about Concordia because it's a very small school. So I had the opportunity to do recital every year I was there, which was really a neat opportunity to collaborate with other students. So I got a lot of accompanying experience in addition to playing solo repertoire. Yeah. And it was just nice to be in that environment where you're living and breathing music every single day.
I hear you. I remember my student days and you still keep in touch
with
them. And it's absolutely. Just that when you're there, you think about nothing but music, you know, and you just eat, breathe, and you're even in having your meals and stuff, you're talking music,
it's
just great.
It is,
but when you leave, it kind of, it changes, doesn't it?
It really does.
Yes.
It's a hard transition, it is.
But I had one teacher, David Sanger, say to me, you must always remain being a student, you know, that attitude of learning, and I think
it keeps
you young, doesn't
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely, yes.
Now, you've studied abroad.
Yes, I have. I had the opportunity to go to Spain and study with Raul Ramirez in his academy there. And he brings together teachers from all over the world, actually, from Russia, Germany, England. And it's a 2.5-week academy, and students from all over the world as well come together. And it's a small group of us, about 8 students. So we had really a lot of one-on-one time with the professors, and we did all our meals together with the professors. And it's just such a unique opportunity to study with world-class artists.
Absolutely. What part of Spain was it?
It was in Mataró, which is about 45 miles from Barcelona.
Yes. And what type of organs did you get access to?
Because
they got some of the finest historic organs in the world,
haven't they?
They do.
We had a beautiful tracker instrument in the main cathedral.
Yeah.
A lot of the organs we were playing on, as you probably know, Spain has a real rough political history, and a lot of them have been demolished. So a lot of the smaller ones we played on were electronic instruments. But we did get an opportunity to tour some local towns and see those organs as well.
Did you get much time, like, on your own to enjoy these organs?
Well, we set up a practice schedule with all the students, and we would practice through the night. So we would take 3-hour blocks. I always somehow got lucky and got the 9 p.m. one. But there were some that would wake up at midnight, and then 3 a.m., and then 6 a.m. Because when you're having master classes and lessons every single day, of course, that's just what you have to do to be prepared for those. So it was we got plenty of time. It was just sleepy time with those organs. So.
I don't know. It's something funny about sleeping with an organ, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, we've all done it.
Yeah, and with the spaces you have to get into for organs, you just learn. You've got to practice at those hours. You do.
When you get to play some of these cathedrals, some of the really big cathedrals, you know, they you can't practice when you've got thousands of tourists, you know, enjoying the building. So you often go in at 11 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
But it's fine, you know.
It
you
is.
Just get your clock ready for that.
Yeah.
Where else have you been abroad?
I got to travel through Germany as well with a choir, and that was a unique experience because it was that whole, you have 30 minutes to prepare for a concert. So I got to play a lot of Baroque repertoire there as well as accompany the choir. Mm. So I did that. It was a 2-week tour through Germany, and then I've done a little bit in Italy as well.
So wait a minute, Germany, where did you start in Germany?
Germany. We started, we ended our tour in Leipzig. We started
Did you go to the famous church?
Yes.
Yeah, you played in
so
St. Thomas, Leipzig.
So beautiful, yes. And we also, we did a concert in Dresden, I believe. Where else? This was about 3 years back. It's slipping my memory now.
Did you get a chance to play some of the Silbermann organs over there?
I don't believe so, but we did get to go see them
In
some of those places.
They're amazing, isn't it?
They are.
They're just some of these little churches with an antique organ. I mean, you can still play an organ over there that Bach had actually sat on, the Trost organ. I remember playing that organ, and he designed that organ.
Yes.
And you sit there, and it hasn't been changed. So you sit there, and you sit on that organ bench, and you think, my, JSB
that's so
on this bench. It makes you feel like this high, really.
It does. I mean,
but
it's
just so beautiful. So you stood by his grave and you saw all that. It just makes you feel part of a great heritage,
It does. And it really set me up for my current position where I'm playing a tracker instrument that was very Baroque design. I think I would have approached this new position very differently if I hadn't had that experience in Germany and really seen the heritage from which this style of instrument comes. It was very valuable.
It is very valuable. Now, you've been to Italy as well. Where have you played in Italy?
Yes. I did not play very much in Italy. I was actually with a choir singing at that point.
But
we did get to play a little bit at the Vatican in the one of the smaller...
You didn't get to play the organ there?
Yes, we did. A little bit. Yes. They had a 1562 organ.
This should be on your resume.
It was very short, you know, it was the 5-minute try out the organ before the mass.
Was it
type
when the
thing,
building was closed or?
They were having a grand mass in the main area, so right. we were in a smaller side cathedral. But yes, it was beautiful, oh, so beautiful, yes. and a 1562 instrument, just incredible to play yes. an instrument that old.
Is it pretty original or?
Yes, from
not been changed.
It didn't sound like it had been changed. According to the friar, it was originally just how it yeah. was. So
these are jewels, aren't they?
They are.
Just, I think they are just amazing. I mean, I yes. think a lot of people needs to get from this country and go into
Absolutely.
Europe and see the yeah. instruments out there. Now here in Bakersfield, what do you do?
I am director of music and worship arts at St. John's Lutheran Church. Mm-hmm. So my main duties are to play the organ, of course,
yes.
Conduct the adult choir, and
so
just
you do
oversee.
It all.
I do, yes.
Right. Okay.
I get to do everything, including teaching in the school.
Right.
I teach music there as well.
So that's so. A full time.
It is very full time.
It is
more
very
than full time. Yes.
So how many services do you do on Sunday?
Just one, actually. We have
that's
a larger
nice
area. Yes, so it's just one. And we have choir that sings every week there. And then I also oversee we're just beginning a concert series as well.
Right,
so we've
right.
had two concerts
yes.
thus far this year. So,
now tell us about the organ.
Oh, it's a lovely instrument. It's 50 rank Bosch Tracker organ in the German style.
Yes.
Has only four levels of memory, which are shared right now between two churches. So it creates some registration challenges, especially uh-huh. when you play a full concert. But I'm learning a lot about, you know, that German style of
yes.
pulling things on and pushing things off. Like
yes.
you did last night.
Yes,
I saw yes. you doing that even here. So, yes.
Is it straight pedalboard?
Yeah, no, it is conclave.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
How many manuals?
It is three manuals.
Okay.
Three manuals.
I bet
yes.
it sounds glorious.
It does. It really does.
Is there any acoustic in a church?
Oh my goodness, yes. I wish you had time to come over and see mm-hmm. it. It is a very live acoustic. It is maybe one of the most live buildings that
know,
I have ever played in.
Do you know how many seconds?
I've been told it's between 3.5 and 4.
Yeah.
But,
okay, and it probably changes when you get an
it
audience.
It does. It does. The people help soak up some of the sound.
I noticed that here last night, actually. I mean, mm. I was surprised because it's the organ is set back, and you know, it's a big building. But even
yes.
with the large audience, the acoustics really did deaden the organ. Even
yeah.
there's not much acoustics in there, actually. But
right,
it did change quite a bit. It's
mm.
it's amazing. That audience is really, it's
yes.
the one thing I think you can never prepare for.
It's so true.
You're so prepared for the repertoire, hopefully,
yes,
you know,
yes.
you've done all your work.
Yes.
But as soon as that first piece starts and you think, wow, is this the same organ? You
yes.
know, in some
yes.
buildings, it's just, that's a difficult aspect
it
of
is.
Concerts, it really is.
It really is, and that combined with the performance excitement, it's always hard to judge, you know,
I know,
am I just hearing it differently or am I feeling it different because of the audience
I know.
Here?
I know,
it's, yeah, it's
I don't have that
thing.
Problem in Balboa Park
yeah.
because we're outdoors, it's the same all the time.
Yes, I'm sure, that's so interesting.
So what do you see yourself doing in 10 years?
Well, I do love church music. I'm actually starting my master's in that this summer, so I want to keep doing that. And one of my goals is really to stay up as far as repertoire goes. I've seen a lot of church organists where it's really easy to let that side fall when you become a church organist because
yeah.
you don't have the time, and it is a struggle. But my goal is to keep playing a lot of concerts as much as possible and learning major repertoire and arranging and all of those good things so that I can keep that side
yeah.
up as well, because I really love playing concerts. I love just sharing the organ with especially audiences that aren't as familiar with it.
Yes.
Children, you
yes,
know.
I know. And if you have an organ like you have, it just inspires you to really go down that road, which
yes.
is very, very important.
Yes.
We get a lot of young students watching the series on the bench.
That's so great.
It is great, and we've had some fascinating advice. Now, what do you, I mean, you're still really young,
yes.
you have lots that you're gonna do, but somebody starting out in the music world and thinking about being an organist, what
mm-hmm.
would you suggest?
I think I would just say go for it, just to take every opportunity you can get. Like, I had no idea all these opportunities that were going to be presented to me. I, you know, 5 years ago, I never would have thought I would have the opportunity to study abroad and, you know, talk to every organist you meet. It's crazy how kind concert artists are. That's something I just never would have, you know, we think of them as celebrities, but I've just learned when you take the time to initiate those conversations and just ask questions and just really be invested, they're so open to sharing
yeah.
with you, and you just glean so much from every yeah. experience that you have in that way. So just go for it. Do everything you can just to take every opportunity.
That's great advice. You're also a member of various organizations. You're a member of the American Guild of Organists.
Yes.
How valuable do you see that?
Absolutely valuable. Yeah. Yes, I have been a member since quite a while. I can't remember exactly when, but they actually provided me with study grant scholarships the last 4 or 5 years through my home chapter, which is Orange County. And that was just invaluable because it just helped pay for organ lessons, which was just wonderful. And then since moving up here, it was just a brand new community to get plugged into the Kern chapter, which they have been incredibly welcoming. They're so wonderful. And the new thing I've been involved with the AGO as well is what's called the Young Organist Chapters, and it's an online community, especially for organists under 30. So each region has its own set of officers. I'm serving on the West region. And it's this Facebook group. We actually have, I think, close to 300 members now. And these are all organists under 30 across the United States. And it's like this community. So we've done virtual concerts and master classes, and we'll live stream concerts. And it's just a great way for dialogue and discussion.
That's brilliant.
So it's been a great opportunity.
That's great.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, online stuff and social media is really how everything is done, isn't it?
Absolutely.
I mean,
somebody
like yourself probably knows exactly what to do with that.
I try.
And do you have any time for hobbies and stuff? Do you do anything else besides?
A little bit.
Busy.
It does keep me busy, but I love to cook. That's one of my favorite things. I have a cute little kitten that I just adopted. I love to hike when I can get outdoors.
Yeah, so that's important, isn't it?
It is.
It is actually exercise for, you know, is getting off that organ bench and doing other stuff.
Yes,
important.
I know we had a conversation about that, just how much better the technique plays
circulation
in your repertoire. Yes, when you've been working out. Yeah,
yeah.
So important. So, one of the things I would love to ask you about is you have just such a unique audience with the Balboa Park. You really reach a crowd that doesn't always hear organs. So what types of things go into your thoughts about programming? How do you reach people that are not just an organ audience?
That's a good question, because not only are you dealing with people who have not heard an organ before, the concerts are free.
Mm-hmm.
So if they find it boring or whatever, they're gone.
Sure.
And I think I grew into the job, obviously. I mean, when I started out, I probably gave a lot more heavier music than perhaps I should have. But you have to play, I've learned, you have to play music that people can connect with immediately and is important to them. Like recently we did a David Bowie tribute, because that was obviously in the news everywhere, and we did it short notice. These things you can't plan, and we had about 4,000 people attend that. So to answer your question, you have to do music that is really, that they know, or if they don't know, they're gonna pick up on a melody or a rhythm pretty quickly. Nothing too long. You can't do extremely long Max Reger works on the Sunday afternoon concerts. We have a Monday night series, and we can do different concerts then, because those Monday concerts, we get people in from the city who have come specifically to hear the more serious repertoire. Sunday afternoons are tourists.
Okay.
So you just have to program nuggets of good music.
So know your audience and program accordingly.
Absolutely.
Yes. Okay. Very good. Very good. Tell me more about what you've done with arranging. What inspires you with your arrangements?
I grew up playing a lot of Hammonds and theater organs, and you have worked with piano copies for that. So from a very early age, I was adapting music, or from orchestral scores, listening to the orchestral scores, adapting it to the organ. Working from piano conductor copies is always very much easier to do.
Sure.
But in the end, you have to work with the instrument you've got. You've got an idea of what orchestrations you should use, but if the organ doesn't have it, you have to think of something else in the palette that's going to make that melody pop out, if you need to make it pop out.
Very good. Very good. Absolutely.
Karissa, it has been a joy to talk to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.